कूजन्तं राम रामेति मधुरं मधुराक्षरम् आरुह्य कविता शाखां वन्दे वाल्मीकिकोकिलं यत्र यत्र रघुनाथकीर्तनं तत्र तत्र कृतमस्तकाञ्जलिं बाष्पवारिपरिपूर्णलोचनं मारुतिं नमत राक्षसान्तकं वैदेहीसहितं सुरद्रुमतले हैमे महामण्टपे मध्ये पुष्पकमासने मणिमये वीरासने सुस्थितम् अग्रे वाचयति प्रभञ्जनसुते तत्त्वं मुनिभ्यः परं व्याख्यान्तं भरतादिभिः परिवृतं रामं भजे श्यामलम्। श्री रामायण सीरीज पार्ट 16 डिफेक्ट ऑफ द बूंस। As Rama's coronation was planned and preparations were going on, Kaikeyi's mind was poisoned by Mathura to somehow stop that coronation and get her son Bharata coronated instead. So Kaikeyi accordingly devised a plan to ask Dasharatha for two boons that she had sought of him years before, and said that she would use those boons whenever she wanted to ask. So she thought time was right now to ask those two boons of the king, and he had to grant it. He was bound to grant it to her because it was a promise that he had made. So as her two boons, she asked that Rama should be sent to exile to the forest for 14 years and Bharata should be crowned instead of Rama. So Dasharatha was in a fix. He did not know what to do because he had great affection for Rama personally, and he also knew that Rama was the most fit candidate to take over the kingdom. But he was under pressure to give this boon to Kaikeyi too. So when he called Rama to give him this news, he was unable to do so, but Kaikeyi herself told Rama that these were the boons that she asked of the king, and the king was bound to grant it to her. He was duty bound, he was word bound to grant it to her. Rama very readily agreed to fulfill his father's words and got ready to go to the forest. He sought permission from his mother Kausalya, who reluctantly gave permission but understood that that was the most righteous thing that she could do. So once Kausalya granted permission to Rama, it is said that Lakshmana was also present with him at that time. And somehow Lakshmana was very upset with the proceedings. He did not want his brother to go to the forest at all. And Lakshmana was known to have a short temper. So when he saw this moving scene of Kausalya interacting with Rama, he couldn't control himself and he spoke to Rama in the following words. He said, "This absolutely does not appeal to me, O Rama. Dominated by the words of a woman, the king has become perverse and he is overpowered by his pleasure of sense. That's why he is sending you to the forest. Which man, having regard for virtue, would forsake a son who is at par with gods, who is guileless, disciplined and even fond of his enemies? Which son who has an eye to statesmanship would be told not to take up the kingdom? Why at all do you have to listen to such a command of the king? I swear to you by my bow and by all my merit attained through truthfulness that I will ensure that I will be with you if you want to overpower our father and take the throne. I'll be with you and you have to occupy the throne, and that would be the best thing to do." Rama was stunned hearing the words of his brother.
But he very calmly told his brother that, "Oh brother Lakshmana, I understand that it is your affection for me, your devotion towards me that is speaking like this. Otherwise, you are so truthful and righteous that you also know that what I am doing is the best thing to do. One cannot disobey his father's commands, come what may. Therefore, give up this unworthy thought of assuming the reins of the government even by taking opposition against the king. This is not righteousness. Please take your stand on righteousness and do not resort to such severity. Let my resolution of carrying out the royal command continue. Please let me go my way." Lakshmana very reluctantly agreed, because for him Rama was everything. He couldn't disobey his brother. So though he had a heavy heart, he ultimately agreed to Rama's stance and did not say anything when Rama told him to be quiet in this matter. Then Rama proceeded towards the palace of Sita. He had to tell Sita all that happened and had to take leave of her. Sita was clueless about anything that was happening. The last instruction she had received was to be praying the Lord along with Rama throughout the night before the coronation. And as they were performing the prayer, Rama was suddenly summoned by the king and he went. And Sita kept wondering why suddenly the king has called Rama. And with this anxiety inside her, she was waiting for Rama. When Rama came back, she asked him what happened. And Rama told her everything. How he had decided to fulfill his father's words and how he would fulfill the boons that his father had given to Mother Kaiki. Sita should have actually got so shattered listening to this. Instead, she was delighted, it seems. She told Rama, "Rama, you know what? I knew something like this was going to happen sometime in my life, because sages in our city Mithila had predicted that this girl will dwell in the forest for many years. Lakshanibhyo dvijatibhyaha shrutvaham vachanam grihe vanavasa kritotsaha nityameva mahabala. Since those sages had predicted forest dwelling for me, I have always prepared myself for living in the forest. And in fact, I am enthusiastic about going to the forest with you. Vanavasa kritotsaha nityameva mahabala. Every day I have been preparing myself to go to the forest, because I knew that predictions of these great sages would someday come true. So come, let's go to the forest. I am all ready," she said. Rama was surprised. He said, "Wait, I am going to the forest. I did not say we are going." And he told her that forest life is really difficult, my dear. You will not be able to bear all those hardships. You stay back here and all that you have to do is take care of your mothers-in-law, be obedient to Bharata who will rule the land, and do not expect that you will be treated like the wives of Bharata, Lakshmana or Shatrughna, because I will not be around here, so you may not get the same kind of treatment. But do not feel bad about that. Think that that is your state now and you have to live by that. And do not sing my praises in front of everybody, because a person who is not in power is not to be praised openly in front of all. That's not a good thing to do. People will not receive it in the right way." So saying, Rama started listing advices for Sita. He started giving long speeches which had hordes of advice for Sita to live alone in the palace of Ayodhya. Sita listened patiently, and at the end of everything she laughed loudly. She said, "Oh Lord, anyways I will listen to all the instructions you say. And some instructions like take care of your mothers-in-law and treat your brothers well and listen to Bharata and do not expect
anything from anybody. All these things I'm already doing. So there's nothing new that I have to do. But above all this, I have my duty as your dutiful wife. Sahadharmacharini, Dharmapatni. And what is that? If you remember, my father had told you when we got married. He said, Chayeva Nugata Sada. She will follow you like a shadow wherever you go. And that's exactly what I have to do now. I have to be with you come what may. That is my highest dharma. And I shall practice only that. In fact, when you go to the forest, I shall go before you and remove all the thorns and stones lying on your way so that you can walk peacefully. That is my duty as your wife. And I shall do that because that's the foremost among duties. Everything else that you listed only follows this primary duty. So if you are going somewhere, there is no question of my not coming. I am going to, of course, come with you. Rama felt good listening to that, but he did not want Sita to come with him because he was worried for her. He thought that she is a princess who has been living in so much luxury. And she has not been commanded by anyone to go to the forest. So why should she suffer the life of living in a forest? So he tried to convince her again. As he was going on convincing, Sita at a point decided that now she has to put her foot down. And what did she do to put her foot down? She gave him a nice shot of words, arrow-like words, it is said. She said, Kintva manyata vaideha, pita me mithiladhipaha, ramaja mataram prapya, striyam purusha vigraham. She said, if you do not take me to the forest, what will my father think about you? He will think that this man was not capable of taking care of his wife in the forest. That is why he left her and went. What kind of a man is he? Is he actually a man? Or a woman dressed up as a man? Striyam purusha vigraham. What will my father think about you? Pita me mithila dipaha, she says. So Rama had no other go but to yield to her after listening to this. Oh my God, this lady has used a trump card now. So what more can I say? If I am going to cause anxiety in the mind of her father who has put his entire trust on me and entrusted her to me, then I have no other say but to keep his heart happy and to take her along with me to the forest. So once she said these words, Rama finally agreed to take her to the forest and then he told her a little secret. He said, see Sita, even I don't like to be separated from you anytime. I also want to be with you always. But I wanted to know your real opinion about being with me. I was a little worried that what if I'm going to forcefully take you along with me just because you're my wife and because of that you had to suffer. So you should not feel that you have been forced into a life like this because of me. I just wanted to know if you inherently wanted to come along with me, which you have proven very nicely. So come along, my dear. Let's go to the forest, he said. And so the husband and wife start getting ready to go to the forest. Then Lakshmana walks in. He says, okay, brother, I'm also ready. Come on, let's go. Rama said, where are you coming, my little one? Why are you coming with me? You have not been told by the king to come to the forest. You have to stay here and take care of our mothers. You have to help Bharata reign the kingdom. Why do you want to come with me? To this, Lakshmana said, how can you even think that I have any existence without you? My lord, you are everything for me. You are my breath. I cannot live without you. I cannot even take a single breath without you. I shall be with you and I shall be with my revered sister-in-law Sita Devi and I shall do everything that is of service to you. I shall do all kinds of service to you as you sleep, as you get up, as you walk and as you roam about in the forest.
Bhavamstu saha vaidehya girisanushuramsyate aham sarvam karishyami jagratas svapatashchate.
He said, I shall do every possible kind of service to you. Aham sarvam karishyami. So, you please take the servant along with you who has no existence without you, without being near you. Listening to these emotion-laden words of Lakshmana, Rama did not have a reply. He said, okay brother, come along, let's go. So the three of them decided to go to the forest as an effect of the boons granted by Dasharatha to Kaikeyi. Dasharatha granted two boons to Kaikeyi, which were actually to send Rama alone to exile and to crown Bharata. But none of the two boons actually got executed exactly to the word, because in the process of executing the first boon, it so happened that Rama went along with Sita and Lakshmana to the forest. And what happened to the second boon, we shall get to know in the further parts. So, as an effect of the boons granted by the king, these three, Rama, Sita and Lakshmana, got ready to go to the forest. How they departed to the forest, we shall see in the next part.
Kujantam Rama Rameti Madhuram Madhuraksharam Arushya Kavita Shakham Vande Valmiki Kokilam Yatra Yatra Raghunatha Kirtanam Tatra Tatra Kritamastakanjalim Vashpavari Paripurna Lochanam Marutim Namataraksha Santakam Vaidehi Sahitam Suradrumatale Haime Mahamantape Madhye Pushpaka Masane Manimaye Veerasane Sustitam Agreva Chayati Prabhanjana Sute Tatvam Munibhyav Param Vyakhyantam Bharatadibihi Parivritam Ramam Bhajeshyamalam.
Sri Ramayana series, part 17, fulfilling his father's commands. As Rama was going to the forest according to the boons given by his father to Kaikeyi, Sita and Lakshmana too decided to proceed with him. And they all came to the royal court to bid goodbye to everybody there. All the sages and all the ministers. Rama wanted to take blessings of all elders before moving to the forest. And so he went to the court. By this time, the news that Rama was going on exile had reached everybody, and everybody were expecting that Rama alone would be going to the forest. But when they saw Sita and Lakshmana accompanying Rama, they could really not bear the sight. Especially Sita being sent to the forest was totally unacceptable to everybody, because everybody knew her as the charming, pampered princess who was to be adored and kept in a high pedestal always. So she going to the forest was unpalatable even to sage Vasishtha, it is said, it seems. As soon as sage Vasishtha saw Sita Devi along with Rama ready to go to the forest, he said, nothing doing. Sita cannot go to the forest with Rama. She must not go. Instead, let her take over reigning of the kingdom. Let her become the queen and let her rule. Bharata will no day accept the throne instead of Rama. I know Bharata. He is such a good boy. So he will not accept the throne. So let this throne be taken up by Sita. Let her rule. But Sita Devi, as we know, was bent upon going with Rama. She had made up her mind. So there was no question of her turning back. At this time, everybody were very upset and irritated with Kaikeyi. And Vasishtha said, all this is bound to happen when you have queens like Kaikeyi. We must have thought a little before marrying, getting a queen like Kaikeyi married into this family. Dasharatha should have never married Kaikeyi knowing her history. What history did Kaikeyi have?
It seems Kaikeyi's mother was a very curious lady, and Kaikeyi's father knew the language of birds, and he had a boon that he could understand whatever the birds speak. But if he told someone else as to what the birds were speaking, then his head would burst into a thousand pieces. So he used to understand the language of birds and he used to enjoy their conversations. It so happened that once when he and his wife, that is Kaikeyi's mother, were strolling in a garden, some birds were speaking to each other, and the king understood that and he laughed his heart out. When Kaikeyi's mother asked him what he was laughing about, he said he could not tell her because he had this predicament that if he were to tell out what the bird spoke, then his head would burst into a thousand pieces. But this lady, the queen, his wife, was so adamant that she said, "It's okay even if your head bursts into a thousand pieces. But I want to know why you were laughing. I want to know that you were not laughing at me and it was something really genuine that the birds were talking. That was funny." So such kind of an unreasonable lady she was. Then listening to the counseling of sages, this king, the father of Kaikeyi, sent his wife on exile so that he could be saved. And that is how he was saved. Knowing this history, I don't know why that day I agreed to the marriage of Kaikeyi with Dasharatha. Only because he has married such a lady that such a day has fallen upon him, the day of disaster, when he has to send his son away to the forest just because he has to listen to the words of this cruel lady. Saying thus, everybody were talking ill about Kaikeyi, and the citizens too tried to plead Rama not to go to the forest. But Rama was firm on his resolve. He said, "Fulfilling a father's promise is something that we have seen repeatedly in history, which has been glorified by one and all. Even if fulfilling a father's promise incurs sin on the son, he is still supposed to fulfill it. I shall give you examples," says Rama. "It seems a cow was slaughtered in the past by the learned sage Kandu in obedience to the command of his father. Even though he knew it was a sin, he did that. Similarly, a tragic death was met in the past by the sons of Sagara. There were 60,000 sons of the king Sagara who all met with a tragic death because they were digging the earth under the command of their father, and in that process they received a curse and they died. So it's okay even to lose your life listening to the command of your father. Not just that, Mother Renuka was beheaded in a forest by Parashurama, the son of Sage Jamadagni, only because he had to obey the command of his father. His father said, 'You behead your own mother,' and he did that. Like that, listening to the father's command and fulfilling it is considered to be the foremost duty of a son, and I cannot go back on that duty of mine. Not only this, it seems," Swami Deshikan says, "that King Dasharatha had a great fear in his mind after Kaikeyi asked for the boons. He had the fear of becoming untruthful because he did not want to grant the boons that Kaikeyi asked. So he thought that, okay, let me not grant her the boons, but I will be called as the untruthful one, which is so unsuitable to the trademark of my race. So he was scared of granting the boons to her, and he was scared of not granting the boons to her for the fear of being called untruthful. This fear, which was in the mind of Dasharatha, was removed by Rama because he himself opted to fulfill his father's promise. Anrita bhaya mushita hridaya pitriva chala palana pratignya vajnata yovvarajya." It is said that in order to fulfill the pratignya of his father, the vow of his father given to his mother, he
did not regard the title of a crown prince as anything. Avagnata Yovaraja. He absolutely did not feel all that throne, the prosperity, the kingdom was worth anything. Nothing was worth not listening to his father's words and not fulfilling his promise for Rama. Such a son he was that he removed the anxiety from his father's mind, the predicament from his father's mind of becoming untruthful. Because of his love towards Rama, probably Dasharatha would have supported Rama if he chose not to go to the forest. But Rama did not want to leave any room for such predicament at all. So he very firmly resolved, decided and said that fulfilling my father's promise is of utmost importance to me and I shall do only that. And by this he also satisfied the doubt that was there in Kaikeyi's mind, it seems. Though Kaikeyi had asked these boons of the king, she always feared whether finally the result would be achieved or not, whether Rama will really go to the forest or not. But now here, the scene was such that he was definitely going to go to the forest because he stood in firm resolve to do so. So Dasharatha finally agreed that his son, daughter-in-law and younger son Lakshmana were all going to the forest. So he decided to send his Chaturanga Sainya along with Rama. That is the army consisting of soldiers, horses, elephants and chariots along with Rama. Looking at this, Kaikeyi became furious again. She said, what is the use of Rama going to the forest with all the retinue? Then he will be all equipped there and here in this kingdom nothing will remain. So you are going to give an empty kingdom to Bharata and also keep the threat from Rama alive. The one who has the army is always going to be more powerful. So he will be a threat to my son and as such you are going to give an empty kingdom to my son by sending away this Chaturanga Sainya along with Rama. What do you think you are doing? I said Rama alone will go on exile. Fine, if Sita and Lakshmana want to follow, I don't have a problem with that. But you cannot definitely send the army along with Rama. She objected. And looking at these cruel words of her, the entire court was really piteously wailing and giving her all kinds of curses in their minds. It was so sad. As soon as Kaikeyi said this, Rama said, oh my dear father, please let me depart to the forest only with Sita and Lakshmana. I do not want anything else. But at this juncture, Dasharatha put his foot down only for one thing. He said, Sita will not go draped as an ascetic to the forest. She will wear clothes of a princess all through the 14 years that you are in the forest. So saying, he packed clothes and jewels for Sita and gave it to Lakshmana and told him to take it along. As for Rama and Lakshmana, they wore bagh garments and they decided to live the life of ascetics in the forest. Before being given these jewels and ornaments to Sita, it seems Sita also tried to wear bagh garments and she was actually not able to do so because she had never even seen such garments in her life. So she was not able to tie those garments and apparently Rama helped her tie it. So all these very beautiful and sweet little things have also been told in Srimad Ramayana by Valmiki. And once she was not able to tie the bar garments, and since the scene looked so sad to everybody, that Dasharatha finally resolved to at least get this thing through, that he will have Sita wearing fine clothes and jewelry all the time she was in the forest. To this, not many people had great objections. So then he told Sumantra, King Dasharatha told Sumantra that you go and at least drop them off to the forest. That at least can be done, even if the whole army cannot go with Rama. Nobody had any objection to this, thankfully. And so Rama, along with Sita and Lakshmana, departed in a chariot which was driven by Sumantra, the trusted minister of Dasharatha. As Rama went to the forest, the entire city of Ayodhya followed. Tulsidas ji says, people felt that they did not have homes in Ayodhya anymore.
without Sita and Rama being there. So they had to go where their home was. So they followed Sita and Rama. Sabahi vicharu kinhamana mahi, Rama lakhana siya binu sukhanahi, jaha Rama tahu sabahi samaju, binu raghubira avadanahi kaju. Without Rama, Lakshmana and Sita, Ayodhya was not their home anymore. So, finally, all of them proceeded towards the forest and the whole city was following. Though Rama kept telling them to go back, they would not listen. They were not in a position to listen. They were all tear-eyed and heavy-hearted. They did not want to depart from the place where Rama was. They could not think of parting from Rama. They just followed. So Rama said, okay, let us camp on the banks of the river Tamasa for the night. And then we shall think of what can be done. So everybody camped on the banks of river Tamasa. And just before it was dawn, Rama hurriedly went and woke up Sumantra and said, now before it is dawn, let us quickly leave this place and go. I cannot take the citizens of Ayodhya along with me to the forest. That would not be right, because I have to leave people behind whom Bharata can rule over. So I cannot take them along with me. So let us proceed without their knowledge. That's the only thing we can do now. And some of them are very vigilant. They might still be awake, pretending to be asleep. So what we shall do is, you drive the chariot, O Sumantra, in the direction towards the palace for some distance. And then from there, we'll take a detour and move towards the forest. So that in case people see my chariot going too, they might feel that I'm returning back to the palace having changed my mind. And they will also then return back home. They will not follow us. So let's use this strategy, said Rama. And Sumantra did accordingly. First he rode the chariot fast towards the direction of the palace and then immediately changed direction after a little distance and drove towards the forest again in great speed. Thus, Rama fulfilled the vow of his father and left for the forest, leaving behind the city of Ayodhya in complete despair. But this is how life is. When testing times comes to a human being, he takes up the path of righteousness, which is very hard for both him and the surroundings. But there is a greater good hidden in that, which is what Lord Rama has taught us through his life. Lord Rama came down to this earth to teach us life values, to teach us how a human being can hold on to righteousness even when the most testing of times come. So every time we listen to stories from the Ramayana, which move our heart, it only reflects on the character of Sri Rama and how a human being should behave when trying times fall upon him. So Rama proceeded to the forest. What happened there, we shall see in the next part.
Kujantam Rama Rameti Madhuram Madhuraksharam Aruhya Kavita Shakham Vande Valmiki Kokilam Yatra Yatra Raghunatha Kirtanam Tatra Tatra Krita Mastakanjalim Pashpavari Paripurna Lochanam Marutim Namataraksha Santakam Vaidehi Sahitam Suradrumatale Haime Mahamantape Madhye Pushpakamasane Manimaye Veerasane Sustitam Agrevachayati Prabhanjanasute Tatvam Munibhyah Param Vyakhyantam Bharatadibhihi Parivritam Ramam Bhaje Shyamalam. Sri Ramayana series, part 18. Finding his first friend, Guha Sakhyam. Sri Rama, along with Sita and Lakshmana, left for the forest from the city of Ayodhya. All the citizens followed, and with great difficulty, Rama managed to cross the borders of the city and come to the Tamasa River. As they were traveling, Rama was drinking as if with his eyes
the beauty of the city of Ayodhya. He was very fond of the city. He looked at the streets, at the markets, at the mangroves and the gardens. And he thought how much he would miss them. And as he was seeing them, he in his heart told them that he would soon be back after fulfilling his vow. Thus, traveling through the city of Ayodhya, he reached the banks of river Ganga to a place named Sringiberapura. Sringiberapura was a land which was populated with the Nishada tribe. The king of the clan was named Guha, and this Guha was a good friend of Rama. Guha, along with his followers, were waiting to receive Rama. They had received the news that Rama is on his way to the forest and he would be crossing their territory to do so. So, Guha, along with his followers, were eagerly waiting for the arrival of Rama. But when Rama actually came in the robes of a hermit, Guha could really not control his emotions. He really felt so sad for Rama. As soon as he saw Rama, feelings were overwhelming in him. But Rama was a prince and he was a Nishada. So he did not know how exactly to greet his friend. He thought he must greet him as any normal person would greet a sage. So he proceeded with folded hands. But Rama, as soon as he saw Guha, after alighting from the chariot, he went and clasped him close to his bosom. He embraced Guha and he told Guha, "My dear friend Guha, I am seeing you after so long. It is so nice to see you. And see whom I have got with me to introduce to you. See this lady. Know her as your friend Sita, my wife." How he is introducing? He is introducing Sita to Guha, that she is his friend. That kind of relationship Rama had with Guha. And then he pointed out to Lakshmana and said, "See this man here. He is your brother, Lakshmana. Oh Guha, this is your brother Lakshmana. And because he is your brother, he is also my brother." So that shows that the Lord held Guha so close to him. He was so close to the Lord in his heart that he gave him the place of a brother. It is said that along with Guha now, Rama had 4 siblings and they were now 5 brothers together. Rama, Lakshmana, Bharata, Shatrughna and now Guha. And like he would introduce a sister-in-law to his brother, he introduced his wife saying that she is like a sister-in-law to you. She is like your friend. This kind of closeness of friendship the Lord showed to a Nishada. Nishada is a tribe which is really not respected too much by anyone, especially in those times. And for the royal families to even look at Nishadas was not allowed in those days. It was forbidden. But Lord Rama actually embraced Guha and introduced his brother and wife as his own brother and friend to Guha. So Thiruvangai Alvar very beautifully says, "Kerai yedalan keelmagan ennadi irangi matravarku innarul surandu maaleiman madanokki untholi umbi embi endru olindilai." He's saying that Rama went and associated with Guha, totally overlooking that he was Yerai, the poor one, Yedalan, the one who never knew to talk in a befitting manner, one who never used good language. In fact, he always used foul language. It seems if people like Guha wanted to tell their mothers to give them food, they would say, "Hey mother, give me food or I'll kill you." That's the way they knew to talk. They did not even know the etiquettes to talk. So they were Yedalans. Yedalan, he says, "Keelmagan, I belong to such a low clan, the Nishada clan. Still, you never minded about anything of that lowliness of mine.
Instead, you came down to me. Ennadu irangi arul surandu. You just showered your grace on me and said, Maraiman madanoki un thori. See this lady having beautiful eyes like the deer. She's your friend, my wife. And Umbi, Embi, this man near me is Umbi, your brother. And so he is my brother, Embi. So, you please accept me too as your brother. That's what the Lord wanted to indicate. This quality of Rama is the greatest of his qualities. That is why he is called as Gunavan. And this quality is known as Saushilyam. Now, what is the meaning of Saushilyam? Saushilyam means Ati Nichaihi Saha Nirandra Samslesham. If one can associate with somebody who is extremely low by birth, position or money in a manner as if this difference never existed between them. There is no difference between a king and a pauper. There is no difference between a wealthy man and a poor man. There is no difference between a learned man and a non-learned man. If a learned, wealthy and pious person thinks that there is no difference between him and somebody who has nothing of these virtues, then he is supposed to have the quality of Saushilyam. It is also called Nirmai in Tamil. Nirmai refers to the quality of water. Water has a quality to always flow freely from higher positions to lower position. If you pour water, it will flow along a slope. So also, the Lord who is in the highest of positions has a tendency to flow down to the lowly ones like us. He never differentiates or he never considers himself superior and tries to stay away from us. He wants association with us. Though we do not have any of the qualities that he has, he wants to befriend us and he wants to be with us. He wants to be associated with us. And that is exactly what he showed by befriending this Guha, by showing sakhyam or friendship to Guha. That's why the Lord is called as Saushilya Sagara by Swami Deshikan. Nishadaraja Saurada Suchita Saushilya Sagara, he says. So once he met Guha and made friends with him like this, Guha offered a lot of hospitality to him. He offered him a feast and told him to partake the same. But Rama told him that I have come to this forest on a vow to live like a hermit, to live like a sage. So it would not be proper for me to accept this feast. I can only eat for my sustenance. So I suggest that if you want to please me, you please feed the horses of the chariot on which I have come. These horses belong to my father. And if these horses are well fed, I would consider myself also well fed. So saying, he went and sipped holy water from the Ganga, offered his evening prayers, and after a while, he went to sleep on Kusha grass along with Sita. Just on a grass made bed, he went to sleep with Sita. Lakshmana at this time was keeping vigil around. He did not go to sleep. So Guha came and asked him, "O Prince Lakshmana, you are also a prince. You are also used to palatial comfort. I have made a bed for you too. So I suggest that you also please go and lie down. And as for safety, you need not worry. I will myself stay up and keep vigil and ensure that you people do not fall in any trouble and no danger will lurk around in this area. And I know this area rather well, so you can trust me and sleep peacefully." To this, Lakshmana replied, "Being protected by you, who keeps only your duty in view, I am sure that we'll be safe. But so long as Sri Rama remains lying down on the ground like this with Sita, how can I even think of sleep? I just cannot think of sleep. I have told my brother that I will serve him day and night. Aham sarvam karishyami jagratas sapatashchate were my words to him when we left for the forest. I cannot even get a wink of sleep, not just today, that all these 14 years till we return back to the palace, it's my duty to take care of the Lord and Sita Devi till we return to Ayodhya. So I cannot even think of sleeping. And Lakshmana now in turn suggested, why don't you go and sleep, O Nishadha king? You are also a king of your tribe. So definitely you also deserve rest. So please go and have good rest. I will take care. But Guha remained awake, it seems. Now, why did Guha remain awake? Because it seems in his heart of hearts, he was not sure if Lakshmana would not betray Rama. Why? Because one of the brothers of Rama, that is Bharata, was quoted as the reason as to why Rama was sent to the forest. Bharata was not responsible for it. In fact, he was not even present in Ayodhya when all that happened. But under the pretext of Bharata, Rama was made to go to the forest. So Rama was having this flight because of one of his brothers. So Guha thought, it seems, that what if this other brother of his simply came along with him just to show off, and then maybe he's been sent as an envoy of Kaikeyi who could actually do away with Rama when he's asleep. How can I trust him? He thought. Such was his love for Rama that he could not even trust that Lakshmana would take good care of him. So he kept awake. It is said that there were some 500 odd followers of Guha. All of them stayed up that night. Why? Because they all were also very fond of Rama. And they had a doubt that both Lakshmana and their leader, Guha, might probably end up getting into a conspiracy of killing Rama. Why on earth would they think like that? But these people had lost trust on anything and everything. Because if a prince like Rama could be banished out of the kingdom and sent into exile, then days are so bad that anybody can become bad at any time. So they lost trust on anything and everything, including their leader, including Rama's brother Lakshmana. So they all thought that maybe these two will make a conspiracy and try to kill Rama. So they must stay awake to protect Rama. And so the entire night, all the Nishadha tribe, the Nishadha king, Guha and Lakshmana, everybody stayed up with the idea to protect Sita and Rama. Such was the love and affection shown by everybody towards Rama. Like this, the entire night went by, and then when it was dawn, Rama and Sita got up and they got ready to leave. At that time, it seems, it is said that the Nishadha Raja told Rama, Guha told Rama that, oh Rama, this Nishadha kingdom of mine, Sringiverapura, is very much your kingdom. You can stay back here. But Rama said, no, my vow is to go to the forest and I have to proceed with that, my friend. So please give me leave. And at that time, he told Guha to get him the milk of banyan tree. Why did he want this? He wanted this to set his hair into matted locks, like how sages have them. Sages do not comb their hair. They do not think about all such beautification and dressing up. They are not bothered about worldly pleasures. So, in order to live the life of an ascetic, Rama decided that he would also wear all that ascetics wear. He was already wearing bark garments. Now, he wanted to set his hair also like ascetics and hermits. So, he told Guha to get him the milk of banyan tree, which he applied on the hair and made it into a matted format, like how the sages have matted locks. Now, Rama and Lakshmana also had matted locks. After they did this, they proceeded on their way on a boat. Before they proceeded, Rama told Sumantra to go back along with the chariot to the kingdom of Dasharatha and tell Dasharatha that they were all safely escorted till the edge of the forest. Rama, Lakshmana and Sita proceeded on a boat through the river Ganga, and in the middle of the stream, Sita Devi offered prayers to Mother Ganga, and they all proceeded now towards the hermitage of sage Bharadwaja. as Rama had left Ayodhya, what was the plight of people in the palace of Ayodhya? Let us see that in the next part.